Hello again. So this lecture is on chapter 37 of your pharmacology book, and this chapter is on anticoagulants and thrombolytic drugs. All right. So anticoagulants are drugs that slow down the blood's ability to clot. And I know that you've heard them called blood thinners, but please, we're nurses. So we don't call them blood thinners. Why? Because they don't thin your blood. Okay. What they do is they slow down the clotting process. And so people have mistakenly called them blood thinners because what happens if you get a cut when you're on them, you'll see that the blood, you know, the bleeding will be difficult to stop. Well, it's not because the blood's too thin. It's simply because the slowdown of the clotting process has made that happen. And we do that because we don't want a patient to form a blood clot. Okay. Or they have an existing blood clot and we don't want it to get any bigger. That's what anticoagulants do. Thrombolytics, which I'm going to go into briefly, are the ones that we call clot busters. So they're the ones that can actually destroy a clot, but there are lots of details and when you can give it and when you can't that make that a little hairy. But the big one I want you to focus on here are the anticoagulants and the antiplatelet aggregators. So we're going to go over those. The first thing that I want to talk to you about are some of the key terms here. It's on the second slide. So you have to familiarize yourself with these words. Hemostasis. Heme or hemo is blood. Stasis means still. Okay. So it's blood that is not moving. Blood is supposed to be constantly in motion, right? And a one-way street. Your vascular system is a one-way street. Everything in your body is a one-way street. Whenever anything in your body goes backwards, there's a problem, okay? So hemostasis is still blood, blood that's not moving. And when blood sits, blood clots. And we don't want that to happen. The word thrombosis means the formation of a blood clot. Thrombus is the blood clot. Embolus is a thrombus, a clot, that actually detaches from a blood vessel and moves, travels through the bloodstream. And a pulmonary embolism is that same thrombus that has detached, turned into an embolus, moves through the bloodstream, and then lodges into one of the pulmonary blood vessels, usually the arterial blood flow to the lungs. And that's a pulmonary embolism. And then MI, myocardial infarction, you know, a heart attack, as most people call it, it's when the embolus, the thrombus that has moves and lodges into one of the coronary arteries, blocks it, and prevents oxygenated blood from going through that artery to whatever portion of the myocardium that artery is feeding, okay? And if we cut off the blood supply to part of the myocardium, the muscle of the heart, then it can't beat, can't squeeze the heart to make it pump. Heart attack, okay? So make sure that you understand those terms and that you're able to use them. So we have oral and parenteral anticoagulants. So what are they used for? They're used to prevent and treat DVT. When we say treat, prevent them from getting larger. So people with AFib, atrial fibrillation, the biggest risk is the formation of a clot, which is embolization. And so we don't want that to happen, and so we anticoagulate them. We also use it for treatment of myocardial infarction that's due to a thrombus. And one of the common uses is the prevention of a thrombus or a blood clot after a surgical procedure, like a valve replacement. We prevent postoperative DVTs in any kind of post-op patient. And we can prevent arterial clotting in heart surgeries. And if the patient's already had a thrombosis in the brain, cerebral thrombosis, a blood clot in the brain vascularity, we can prevent another one from occurring. So who do we not give them to? You know, of course, anybody who's hypersensitive to the drug. Anyone who's actively bleeding, anyone who has a bleeding disorder, in other words, a hemorrhagic disease, which would be something like von Willebrand's disease or hemophilia, right? People with tuberculosis, leukemia, which is cancer of the blood, and then sometimes uncontrolled hypertension, gastric ulcers, because these drugs can make them bleed. Recent surgery of the eye or the central nervous system, If they have an aneurysm, we don't want that thing to blow. And anybody that's got really severe or significant renal or hepatic disease. And of course, you know, breastfeeding mothers and pregnant women should not take them, period. Okay. And by the way, if a woman is prescribed, if she's of childbearing age and is prescribed an anticoagulant, she must use not only a reliable form, but we usually say two forms of birth control. Okay, because we do not want her to become pregnant when she is on these meds. So you ask, what are the meds? Glad you asked. Let me tell you. And so on your must-know med list, you've got number one, warfarin, a.k.a. Coumadin and Jantavin. That is the oral anticoagulant, warfarin. Then you have heparin. Heparin is given subcutaneously or IV. Enoxaparin, a.k.a. Lovenox, which is also called, and please remember this, a low molecular weight heparin. It's given subcutaneously. And then for the antiplatelet aggregators, we've got clopidogrel, also known as Plavix, and then good old aspirin, right? So if you see a patient that's on a low-dose aspirin a day, the baby aspirin, 81 milligrams, it's not because they have pain. It's used as an antiplatelet aggregator for people that have cardiovascular disease. Okay, and so remember, when we talk about these meds, anticoagulants prevent the formation and extension or growth of a thrombus. They do not destroy an existing blood clot. Okay, they do not. Just make sure you remember that. Okay, let's talk about warfarin first. Good old warfarin. There's a lot to talk about. So, warfarin is the oral anticoagulant. A patient that is on warfarin must have regular blood work done. And the blood work that they're having done is the PT, prothrombin time, and the INR, international normalized ratio. Remember that, because sometimes ATI will call it international normalized ratio. They won't say INR. The PT, the prothrombin time, is measured in seconds. If someone is on warfarin, therapeutic would be considered to be anywhere between about 16 to 26 seconds, okay? Because therapeutic is 1.5 to 2 times normal. And the normal value for a PT is 11 to 13 seconds. So that 16 to 26 is about 1.5 to 2 times the normal value. And the INR is a whole lot easier, which is why they even came up with it in the first place, because it just needs to be between 2.0 and 3.0. That is considered therapeutic. If for some reason the patient, their INR is higher than it should be, higher than a 3.0, if they have, you know, bleeding issues, vitamin K, also known as phytonadione, is the antidote. And it can be given to instantaneously block the effects of warfarin and prevent bleeding. Okay? So patient education, what do you have to teach your patient for warfarin? Make sure that they understand that there are foods that contain large amounts of vitamin K. And oh, fun fact, please don't confuse vitamin K with potassium. Potassium, the electrolyte, is represented as a K with a plus sign. It is a positive cation. It is an electrolyte, potassium, K. Vitamin K is a fat-soluble vitamin, typically stored in the liver, okay? And so the thing you have to teach patients is consistency. If they like foods that have large amounts of vitamin K, we're not going to tell them not to eat them. What we're going to tell them is to be consistent with their diet. So if you look at page 9 or slide 9, there's a list of foods, and the biggest notorious vitamin K foods are the green leafy vegetables, kale, spinach, turnip greens, collards, collard greens, mustard greens, romaine lettuce, okay, vegetables like Brussels sprouts, broccoli, cauliflower, cabbage, and even some fruits have higher levels of vitamin K in them, and the ones that are the bad ones are prunes, kiwi, and avocado, okay? So you're going to teach the patient, if these are foods that you like and you eat them regularly, like you like to have a spinach salad twice a week, then you must always have a spinach salad twice a week. Otherwise, the INR is going to be going up and down, and we're not going to know how to dose this patient, right? We're going to have to keep changing the dosage, because if 1 week they eat spinach 5 days, that's a lot of vitamin K. And so their Coumadin level, the INR, is going to go low, vice versa. Okay, so make sure you understand that concept. When we talk about other instructions pertaining to warfarin, they should take it daily, same time each day, never double dose. So if they forget to take it one day, they should not take two. Warfarin is one of the ones that's kind of slow to take effect. It takes about a week for them, for the drug to become effective. Again, women of childbearing age, two forms of birth control, wear a medic alert bracelet. Why? Well, if the person on warfarin is in an accident, let's just say, and they're brought into the ER and they're unconscious, I don't know that they're on an anticoagulant, and we have to do an emergency surgical procedure on this patient, and then they're going to just start bleeding all over the place. So it really is helpful for us to just say, oh, look, they're on warfarin. It's right there on their bracelet. We know we can give them vitamin K to prevent that bleeding and then go ahead and do whatever we need to do to save their life. And then bleeding precautions, which apply to warfarin, but also apply to all anticoagulants and antiplatelet aggregators. I'm going to go over just, bleeding precautions in general. And again, they apply to all of these medications. And then with the warfarin, make sure the patient knows don't take aspirin. And don't take NSAIDs because they will increase the risk for bleeding. And if the patient needs to have any kind of medical or dental procedures done, they must let the doctor or the dentist know beforehand because there's an increased risk of their bleeding. Okay, makes sense? All right, next, and I put these two together, heparin and enoxaparin. Heparin is given either subcutaneously or intravenously. And the antidote for heparin is protamine sulfate. Make sure you know that. Now, the lab test for heparin is not the PT and it's not the INR. It's the PTT or the APTT, which stands for partial thromboplastin time or activated partial thromboplastin time. Okay? So these are measured in seconds as well. And the normal time for the PTT is 60 to 70 seconds, APTT is 25 to 35. So for the patient to be therapeutic, they should be 1.5 to 2.5 times normal. In other words, and it's right on the slide, if you are on heparin, I should see a PTT somewhere around 140 to 170 or an APTT somewhere around 60 to 80. And heparin, by the way, is the quickest working, right? Not only because of the route, but because of the drug. So yes, given intravenously, boom, works immediately. But even given subcutaneously, it's going to work very quickly that day, as opposed to warfarin, which, like I said, takes about a week to get moving. You may very typically see a patient on heparin and warfarin. And you think to yourself, they can't be on two. They can, because if we need to get a patient anticoagulated quickly, we'll get them on the heparin and we'll start them on the warfarin. Because remember, the warfarin takes about a week. So the heparin is going to get them therapeutically anticoagulated. And then when it's time to send them home, we send them home just on the warfarin, okay, and stop the heparin. And then enoxaparin is a low molecular weight heparin, and that is given subcutaneously only. This is the one that you're going to see given prophylactically, in other words, for a patient that's post-op, after having, a medical or surgical procedure and they're not moving, any immobility, we're going to give them enoxaparin to prevent a surgically induced DVT. Some facilities will give heparin prophylactically. It depends. But typically enoxaparin, Lovenox, is the one that's given that way. Okay. And then we've got the last two, which are the antiplatelet aggregators, aspirin and clopidogrel. So these do not stop clot formation with clotting factors or vitamin K or fibrin or fibrinogen. These work on your platelets, okay, thrombocytes, and they prevent them from getting stuck together, okay? So aspirin, good old-fashioned aspirin, I said earlier, 81 milligram low dose is very typical. Clopidogrel, which is also known as Plavix, is also an antiplatelet aggregator. They're still going to be on bleeding precautions. They should not be taking any NSAIDs along with these meds because, again, bleeding risk is increased. They should not or should be at least cautiously watched if they're taking either digoxin or phenytoin. Digoxin is an antiarrhythmic. Phenytoin is an anticonvulsant, anti-seizure medication. Because if they're taking these meds and they're taking dig or phenytoin, these meds can actually increase the serum levels of those two drugs, and that can be dangerous. They can become toxic, either dig toxic or phenytoin toxic. So make sure that you remember that. Okay. What else do we need to know? Bleeding precautions. And again, these apply to all these anticoagulants and antiplatelets. Never use a razor, nothing sharp, okay? Because if they slip and cut themselves, they're going to bleed. They should only be using an electric shaver. They should only use a soft bristled toothbrush because anything medium or hard, they may see some bleeding gums. You should teach the patient to be checking their urine and stools for any bleeding. So hematuria, melena. So when there's blood in the stool, it can present as black, dark, tarry looking stools, which is hidden blood. It's indicative of a GI bleed, and that's called melena. Or they can actually just see red blood in their stool, and they need to report that immediately. You should also be taking note of any unexplained ecchymoses, that black and blue marks, right? So where are all these black and blue marks come from? I don't know. That's a concern. Or petechiae. And petechiae are those little red marks, almost like little peck marks on the skin. Because ecchymoses and petechiae both can indicate some type of a bleed inside. Any vomiting that looks like coffee grounds, coffee ground emesis, that is an indicator of an upper GI bleed. Okay, so you won't see blood, but the vomit will look just like coffee grounds because the blood mixes in with the acid in the stomach and so on. So that needs to be reported immediately. That's an emergency. And then fall precautions. If the patient's at home, no throw rugs. Make sure they have grab bars in the bathroom. Everything should be well lit. There should be no extension cords running across floors because if they fall, bleeding can be difficult to stop and can cause them serious harm or death. If they hit their head and they're on an anticoagulant, they can have a subdural hematoma or a subarachnoid bleed. In other words, a bleed in the brain that can kill them. So that's very important to remember. And then herbals. They should never take garlic, feverfew, ginkgo biloba, ginseng, or fish oil. These are herbs that increase the risk for bleeding. Okay, make sure that they know that. All right, so we are moving right along, and I'm going to talk to you briefly about thrombolytic drugs, even though you may not get a question about it, but I'd like for you to at least have heard it. So thrombolytic drugs, these are drugs that actually will destroy an existing blood clot. But here's the thing, timing, okay? These drugs have to be given within the first 3 hours after the patient displays symptoms. So in other words, patient has symptoms of a stroke or CVA, and they can be things like a droop on one side of the face, sudden onset of slurred speech, those kinds of things. They should go right to the hospital because if they are having a stroke and it's because of a clot, we can give them streptokinase or TPA, and we can actually destroy the clot and save them from having any deficits, right? Imagine that. Here's the problem. When older people have these symptoms, here's what they think. I don't want to go to the hospital. Maybe it'll just go away. And so I'll just go to bed. Maybe I'll feel better in the morning. So they wait. And then when they go to the hospital the next day and we ask them, when did these symptoms start? And they say, you know, yesterday, I don't really remember exactly what time it was. Too late. Too late. Can't give it to them. Okay, so that's the caveat with those drugs, just so you've heard of what they are. And they're used to treat a myocardial infarction, like I said, or stroke, because they do what's called lysis. Lysis means, by the way, destruction of. So they perform lysis of the blood clot in the arteries. They go right to the blood clot and boom, destroy it. So they treat either acute myocardial infarction or CVA. And they can also treat a blood clot that's causing a pulmonary embolism or DVT. Right? Stop it right in its tracks. Adverse reactions, I mean, as you would well imagine, there's always a risk for bleeding. And the big one is internal bleeding. So a brain bleed, like I described earlier, is one of the biggest risks with these thrombolytics. And, you know, one of the important things would be to constantly be checking for increased intracranial pressure in the patient, because that is a notorious sign of a brain bleed. Okay. And then, of course, if you're giving a thrombolytic with any other medication that's an anticoagulant or an antiplatelet, well, now you've exponentially increased their risk for bleeding. So with everything, medications, treatments, et cetera, it's always what's the risk and what's the benefit? These are the questions that we ask ourselves all the time. Okay. The next few slides go through the nursing process and nursing diagnoses. And, you know, what do we want as an outcome? Every slide in every one of these PowerPoints tells you optimal response to therapy. What does that mean? Well, it means that if they're on warfarin, their PT and INR are within therapeutic range. They have not developed a new blood clot, right? Makes sense? So whatever we're giving the drug for, is it doing what it's supposed to do the way it's supposed to do it? That would be what, you know, we're looking for, our expected outcome, okay? So that is about it for these meds. Make sure that, you know, you understand the lab tests that I talked about. Make sure that you understand and remember what the therapeutic ranges are. That's very important, okay? The PTINR and the PTT or APTT. So that's about it for this PowerPoint, and I'm going to move on to the next one in a minute. Nice to see you again. Questions, hit me up. You know where to find me.